I think most everyone who went on the trip would agree that being with the kids was like one of the best parts of the whole trip. So like the first day we went, you know, they were all like kind of shy, and you know, you'd start playing and stuff, and they'd be cool with sports.
They would play soccer, we'd play volleyball, and like by the end of the trip, they were like crying, we were kind of crying.
You know, you'd have like four kids on your legs, like pulling you, like they didn't want you to go.
These kids like didn't have like anything, you know, they were in this like poverty-stricken place, but they were just so joyful.
It was definitely cool to see the kids there and how they worship the Lord, and compare to me with how much I have versus what they have.
Like, they were just praising Jesus, like, so happily and, like, with, like, all their hearts. So it was just really amazing to see that.
Yeah, I think it definitely made me realize how much I take for granted here. I mean, we have a whole building dedicated to, like, being able to have chapels and worship. And I think I've not fully taken that opportunity to really grow in my faith.
It made me like think that like I should be more grateful for what I have, because like I'm not even that joyful. I have like all this stuff.
So I think that part was really cool, just to see the joy they had. And then I'm kind of like, what's my excuse to not have that same joy? I just kind of have like a renewed heart that's kind of just like ready to grow. I think I just caught going through the motions. I mean, I've been at Troy Christian since forever, pretty much. I got just used to everything, and I started taking it all for granted. So definitely this year and this trip just kind of, just like renewed that fire.
So one of the big things that Mr. Smith was teaching us on the first night was, after we had been like carrying buckets all day, he said, isn't it nice when you're carrying something heavy and someone takes a step towards you to help you carry that weight? And like that hit me, and I know it hit a lot of the other people that were on the trip. And so that night sparked a lot of different conversations between people, like one-on-one. I talked to one of my friends who had been going through something like really heavy with like some of their friendships. And I did not know that this person was going through that at all, but they came to me and they said that I was a person that they could give their weight to and I could help them through that. And so that meant a lot to me that friend saw me as one of those people. On the last night of the trip, there was another group that was with us, and we were all doing worship together, and we were worshiping for probably an hour or two, but it felt like 10 minutes. Like, it didn't feel like any time had passed. And everybody was like crying and hugging each other, praying over each other and praising God. Like, you could feel his presence like no other. I think that was the most powerful experience that any of us had had.
It was just really cool to see how God was working and changing in our lives. I was one of the people who were on the trip, and I got inspired to get baptized. And that was something in my life that I had always like drove away from, because I was scared about like doing it in front of people. On the trip, I heard Mr. Smith talking about how they had done baptism before. And that night, it just like stuck with me. And I just went and sat down. There's this platform down by the water. The waves are crashing, and I just sat there and I just looked up at the stars, and I was just like, God, is this what I'm being called to do? And I truly felt his call to do that. And I went to Mr. Smith and I was like, Mr. Smith, this is something I'm serious about. And we made it happen, and I'm so thankful that it did. And that completely has changed my life.
Yeah, for me, like, going into ESM, I was kind of like one of those Christians that had like one foot in and one foot out, or maybe even like one foot in and like your other foot half in, like your toes in. Like, I was really close to being like all for him, but there was just like something holding me back. And through ESM, with not having our phones and having like the different relationships with people, it like changed my heart. And since I've been home, I've been replacing screen time with journaling and with praying and with reading my Bible every night before I go to bed, and praying as soon as I wake up in the morning instead of getting on my phone to check it.
I'm more intentional about the way I think and the way I love others, and how one of the biggest things that I'm struggling with and trying to like work on is having a serving heart in everything that I do. That's one of the things that's like changed in my life, is it's no longer about like me. It's how can I show the love of God to others, and how can I serve them?
We were inspired to like bring this back to TC and back home, and we were really diving into how can we take the things that we'd been learning and the relationships that we've been forming without our phones and the power that we've been feeling of God, and how can we bring that back to Troy with us and spread that to the school and make a change in the school.
We're wanting to really come back to school and like make this change. We're tired of just like this weird atmosphere we have where like we can't talk about certain things or we can't open up about things, and we're ready to just, like Chapel's been speaking about all year, is like having this community, like being vulnerable with each other and stuff, and we're ready to do that. And some of the first steps is like meeting in groups and just connecting with people who beforehand like you would have never thought to been able to connect with, or who you would have even thought you're relatable with. But in reality, like faith and stuff, that is the ultimate connector between people. And it has connected all of our ESM trip. And I know it's more widespread than just that. It's happening on the, it happened on the other trips, and it's happening within our school.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to chapel. We have got a really powerful chapel today. We have Lauren and Dylan. They're doing a tag team today, and we're gonna do things a little differently. So we're just gonna do one worship song. Then you guys are gonna sit back down, and Dylan and Lauren are gonna speak, and then we're gonna come back up for three more songs after a time of reflection. So if you guys would stand up and put your arms around each other. Dear Lord, thank you for this time. Thank you that all of us could be here right now to worship you. We wanna welcome you into this place right now. And I pray that Dylan and Lauren's message today would touch the hearts of everyone in here. We pray that you would be over this place, and that you'd keep us all safe going into prom tomorrow and through this weekend. In your name we pray, amen. Just a piece of the sky.
Thanks for worshiping. You can go take your seats.
Well, good morning, everyone. Dylan and I are super excited that we get the opportunity to share with you today. In light of recapping some of the different ESM trips, we are eager to unpack a little bit about what we experienced. Both of us went on the Jamaica trip to the parish of St. Mary, and our group mainly served in and around its capital city, which is called Port Maria. There have been many times in my life when I was sitting in a seat, just like you all are today, listening to a pastor or adult of some sort speak about a mission trip experience. They stood up on a stage like this, went through a slideshow of pictures, and talked about what a great experience they had. Well, every time I sat through a sermon like that, it went right over my head. I would get up at the end of the service and think, wow, that's so great for them. I'm so glad. They're spiritual leaders who have it all figured out, and they're living good Christian lives. And many of you may be thinking that exact same thing right now. But listen, Dylan and I are students and teenagers just like the majority of you here. And so hear me when I say that now, being on the other side of it, I get it. Once you experience God in such an eye-opening way, you want everyone to know about it, and you want that experience for them too. Today, that is my prayer for every individual in this room, that you would be inspired to relentlessly pursue Jesus and to strive to experience him in a brand new way.
And I want to see the same spiritual change that took place in my life in Jamaica back here at home, because Jamaica was an incredible experience for me, and it definitely changed my life. And our lives should be transformed by God. We are called to live differently, and our day-to-day lives should reflect that change. God has called us to live differently because we have a relationship with him, and our lives should be filled with constant joy just for the fact that Jesus died on the cross for our sins, just for the fact that God exists and he loves us and he provides for us. Living here in America, though, we have so many privileges that a lot of other people don't have. And we're so blessed to have these things, but so often we find ourselves complaining about a bunch of little things that go on throughout our lives. But the Jamaican people were just happy to wake up and spend time with each other. They were grateful for like the four walls and like the metal roof that they got, and they were grateful for whatever food or meals they got to eat that day. And a lot of times back here at home, we complain about food, we're picky eaters, we complain about things within our own homes. Maybe some of you have found yourself complaining that you don't have a TV in your room, something like that. And I know a lot of us complain about having to get up and go to school each morning. But a lot of those things are very insignificant compared to the poverty that the Jamaican people experience. And so we don't really have a reason to complain. God wakes us up in the morning and he sustains us. And that should be good enough for us, because God should always be good enough. And this takes a perspective change, and it takes a different mindset. And it may even take an eye-opening experience to realize these things. And one of those experiences for me was definitely ESM this year. And honestly, it was probably the best trip I've ever been on in my entire life. And I grew so much closer to God and so much closer to my classmates. And God was working tremendously throughout my life and throughout that whole trip. And I'm really starting to see a big change in my life.
So while down in Jamaica, we partner with an organization called American Caribbean Experience, or ACE, and we served in a variety of ways. However, rather than focusing on the physical projects, Dylan and I want to talk about how we experience God, from how we saw him moving throughout the week to the spiritual awakening that happened in our lives. Dylan and I felt God moving at different points throughout the week, but we also shared some of the same spiritual experiences, which was super cool. For me, there are three main areas or moments that I want to highlight in our time today. And the first is the Jamaican people. So we got to work with a wide age range, from children as young as 3 or 4 to elderly folks in their 70s and 80s and everyone in between. But I will never forget the pure joy that radiated from the kids. It wasn't just the fact that they were always smiling and laughing, running around, giggling, but it was that these children showed me and I experienced a kind of love through them that is very uncommon to see in our world today. And that's God's love. Without knowing literally anything about us, keep in mind we were strangers to them, they embraced us with open arms. On the work site in particular, the children would come home from school in the afternoon and they would just run up right up to you and jump into your arms. They would ask you to play with them. They would sing with us or they would just even have small conversations. And in the schools that we visited, the second we walked into the room, their faces lit up. Like, just the excitement they had from just us being there was so cool to see. And as for the adults and the elderly, they shared their stories with us and offered encouragement and wisdom. During our elderly visits, we would sing worship songs and read scripture and pray together. But even though we were there to bless them, it often felt very backwards for me. One specific instance that comes to mind is when myself and a small group of students was visiting with a younger couple. And they lived in roughly a 6 by 6 foot home with made of four wooden walls. And it wasn't much bigger than some of our closets, if I'm being completely honest with you. And they were singing and praying over us. This younger couple was singing and praying over us. I just stood there thinking, like, wow, this is unbelievable. They have so little, yet are trying to be a blessing to us. And another gentleman comes to mind also. His name was Mr. Rose. Mr. Rose was handicapped. He had half of a leg, and as you might imagine, he was wheelchair bound. Mr. Rose had so much wisdom to offer, and I could talk about him. I could go on and on. But the one thing that really stuck with me was the fact that he was so adamant about giving and serving those in need in his community. He made a living from weaving bracelets and necklaces and bags and sandals. I'm actually wearing 2 of his bracelets today. But even though he was in physically poor condition, his spirit surely was not. He spoke passionately, as I said, about giving and providing for those in need around him. And I was just completely blown away by that. Like, that just didn't make sense in my head. And I thought to myself, I have the audacity to complain about the smallest inconveniences in my life and when I'm asked to do something that I'd rather not do. Like, that's just absolutely pathetic. That's what I kept saying to myself. I mean, when you think about it in the grand scheme of things, guys, our first world problems are not even really problems. These people struggle to meet their basic needs on a daily basis, and we get upset when a restaurant messes up our order. It's pretty bizarre. And overall, within each of these interactions, just the Jamaicans had a sense of joy and passion and contentment like I'd never seen before. Despite their circumstances, living in poverty, and many of them in poor health, they truly demonstrated what it looks like to live thankful and content lives. They had absolutely nothing compared to what we have, and still those of them that were believers were so on fire for Christ. It was just inspiring to see.
Yeah, the Jamaican people had so much passion for God, especially at the church service. So we went to church on Sunday, and I'm going to paint you a little picture of what it was like. So first of all, we're in someone's garage. There's probably only like 6 to 8 people there, not including the 2 pastors. There's a bunch of metal folding chairs set up for us because we like triple the size of their church just by us being there. It's super hot. It's super humid. I'm already sweating through my clothes, and I know some of my classmates are already sweating through their clothes as well. And the service lasted about 2.5 hours long, but it was by far the best church service I've ever been to in my entire life. They just spoke with so much passion and fire, and I'd never seen that much passion in a group of people in my entire life, and I've never really seen anyone like just have that much faith and passion in God before. And like, again, we were sitting in a garage. Like, it's still crazy to me to think about, because here we have the APAC, and then like in our own church, like you have a building, you have lights, you have a stage, we probably have a screen, like you have all that stuff, but they were just in someone's garage, and that was the reality of their every Sunday, their church service. They wake up and they go to this little garage with their community of like 6 to like 10 people, but they don't care about any of that stuff, and they're just so happy to gather and praise God. And they displayed more faith in God than anyone I'd seen before. And I remember one point during the message, I was just like crying and I was super emotional. And throughout the whole church service, I was really super emotional. But stuff just kept hitting me in wave after wave. And I remember the Jamaicans talking about how they were praying for rain because they hadn't received rain in a while, and they were expected to have like more drought, and they weren't expected rain until like 2 months from now, like sometime like late in May. But they had gathered together and they started to pray about the rain, and without a shadow of a doubt, they knew that God would answer those prayers, and he did. And it had been raining the week prior to us getting there, and it continued to rain throughout the week so much that one day we had to basically just cut our work project short because it was just pouring and pouring, and they had been going through a drought and weren't expecting rain for a while. But they gathered together, just like 6 of them, and they prayed, and they knew that God would answer those prayers. So again, like, the amount of faith they had just blew me away, and the amount of passion that they spoke with, and how they just felt so blessed, and all they talked about was them being blessed, and they were so content with all of that, and it just kept like blowing me away, like over and over again. Like, they spoke like God was just physically in front of them, like sitting in the front row, like they were just pouring out their hearts to him, and it was excuse me, it was just an amazing experience. And back here at home, like, we complain about things in our worship service and our chapels. We complain that we don't like the song that we're singing. We complain that the message went too long or too short. Or we complain about, like, we don't like who's singing. Like, it's all so incredibly stupid and insignificant when you think about it. Because worship isn't about us. It's about giving God glory and praise. A worship service is not designed to meet our needs and wants. We're supposed to be praising God. And yet so often it has become that way, and we've developed a selfish mindset when it comes to worship. We were in Bible class the other day, and I was kind of mentioning this to our class, and Mr. Williams brought up a story about two women who had come out of a church service, and the first lady was like talking about how amazing the service was and how she really enjoyed the worship, and it was just a really cool experience for her. But the second lady started to complain about the last song that she sung, and how she didn't really care for it. And the first lady turned to her and said, "Well, good thing we weren't singing it to you." And that just really stuck with me, because so often we develop that selfish mindset and we think like the worship service should meet our needs, but that's not what it's about. Like, we're praising God. It doesn't matter what song you sing. All that matters is that you have your voice singing praise to God. And you don't need like a bunch of lights or a stage or a screen or any of that. And while that stuff's all okay, but when the materialistic things take priority over God is when it becomes a problem. And Jamaican people were in a garage, and that didn't matter to them. And we had to like play their own instruments for them. And like, they were singing, like, I'm not gonna lie, like off tune, off key. Like, it was kind of rough, but they didn't care about that, because they were just worshiping God. And it didn't matter to them what they sounded like or what we thought it sounded like. All they cared about was that they were giving praise to God. And so it was just super eye-opening to me. And they were like speaking out throughout the whole service. There wasn't a single point where someone wasn't yelling like amen or like hallelujah. And they just had so much fire and passion. And I want that same fire and passion in my life and for my church and here at TC. And one of the reasons I'm going to be a pastor is because I want people to have this same passion that I have. I want everyone to have this passion, and I want everyone to experience this passion for God that the Jamaican people have. And that's the change I want to see. And I just want people to experience God the same way I did. And I want people to have friends with them that can walk alongside them in their faith journey, because God created us for a community, and we're supposed to walk alongside each other in this journey. And I grew so much closer to so many people during this trip. But honestly, growing closer to people spiritually had always kind of been a struggle for me in my own life. And I've just always felt like I've been alone in my faith journey, and that I didn't have anyone to talk about my faith with. Like, obviously, I had a bunch of friends, but I didn't really feel like I had friends that I could go into deep conversations with and share my faith. And even within my own friend group of guys who I'd consider my closest friends, we never really had those type of conversations. And so one night, I was telling someone on the trip about all the stuff I was going through, and I was telling them, you know, how I was feeling alone and how I was struggling with all this stuff and how I felt like I had to walk by myself. And afterwards, I went back to my room where the guys were, and the mood was kind of light, and they, you know, were just kind of joking around, and they're like, oh, like, what'd you talk about? Like, not really taking it seriously. And I kind of just, like, poured out my heart to them and told them, like, what I had been feeling and what I talked to them about. And the mood just, like, instantly flipped, and they just kind of got quiet and just, like, stared at me and were like, oh, like, he just kind of, like, was being super serious. But immediately afterwards, they started to open up and share their faith, and they shared about their walks with God. And I didn't even know where some of them stood with God previously. But now specifically, I have two new friends who I can walk alongside with in my faith, and we can grow and hold each other accountable. And it took me finally stepping out of my comfort zone and taking the steps to pursue that. Because I had been complaining to God about it, but I wasn't actually doing anything about it. But when I did, God opened the door for that conversation. God will move for us, but he also needs us to move with him. I went to Living Word Church a few weeks ago, and it was actually probably like a week after we got back from Jamaica, and I heard this quote from the pastor there that really stuck with me and applies to the situation. He said, "If you stop telling God the way it is, he might turn it around for you." And that was Pastor Pat from Living Word. I'll say that one more time. If you stop telling God the way it is, he might turn it around for you. And that's exactly what I was going through. I was complaining to him. I was trying to get God to work on my own agenda and like tell him, well, if you just do this and this, then maybe it'll actually help me. But he just kind of, after I shared with my friends, he kind of like hit me over the head that night and was like, Dylan, like it's not that hard. Like you just have to move with me. Like I'm already setting stuff in motion. I'm already opening doors. You just have to take the steps to move, because God opens doors for us constantly when we ask. But the funny thing about an open door is that it's useless if you don't walk through it. So you have to take the steps to walk through and experience that change. And that's what I finally did. I took that action, and God created something wonderful out of it. And it was so amazing, and I'm so excited to grow closer to those friends. And just throughout the whole trip, everyone was bonding, and we all had one-on-one conversations with each other. And if you ask anyone on that trip, they'll tell you that those were the most like amazing, beneficial conversations we've ever had like in our entire lives. And we all just grew so close to each other through those. And by the end of the week, like the conversations had just become routine. Like we expected to have that. Like it almost like we scheduled like our own meeting times to have that by the end of the week. But it took each of us being intentional in our conversations and relationships with each other to see that growth and change.
Bonding with classmates was also a huge area of impact for me as well. Beginning earlier in the week, Monday or Tuesday night, after our group debrief, students would go off and have one-on-one discussions, like Dylan was saying, and they would last for up to several hours. We would also have smaller group discussions as well. But these were not just random conversations. As Dylan was mentioning, they were very deep and intentional. Not having our phones the whole week was probably the best thing that could have ever happened. Didn't think I'd ever say that. It forced us to talk to one another, and I'm so thankful for that. Many of us shared our faith with one another for the first time, like Dylan was saying with his friends. I did the same. And finding out where we were all at in our journeys, through that we were able to connect on a whole new level. I talked to people I had never spoken more than a few words to before for extended periods of time. And so new friendships were formed and others of mine were just simply strengthened. But not only did we get to bond with our classmates, we also got to spend time and grow closer with the other group of students that was staying at our hotel. They were a group of college-age kids from Tifton, Georgia, and they were there on a church mission trip. On the final night of the trip, we got the opportunity to come together for a time of worship. This specific moment in time, which actually lasted for about 2 hours, will forever live in my head. And let me preface this by saying it was about 8 p.m. Friday night. We all had to pack and be in our rooms, showered and ready for bed by 11 because we were getting up the next morning to travel back to the States, like 5 a.m., super early. And so myself and some TC students were sitting by the pool just chatting, waiting for the college students to join us. And I remember looking at my friend Lily and I said, geez, I don't really know if we have time for this. We have a lot to do. And I can't believe I ever said such a thing. What came next was the most incredible time of worship I have ever been a part of. 40-some voices with one guitar gathered under a small pavilion was all it took for God to turn lives upside down. Started out like any other time of worship. We jumped right into singing. I remember the first song we sang was Graves into Gardens, which we sang last week in chapel. But it was either the second or third song. It was called Oceans. Very popular song. I'm pretty sure most of you are familiar with it, but I'd never been a huge fan of it. All of a sudden, though, tears just started streaming down my face as we sang the words, Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. In that moment, I had no idea why or how. I was so overwhelmed. But there is no other explanation than the sheer power of the Lord's presence. Moments later, several of my classmates also began to weep, and within minutes, the majority of everyone around me was visibly affected in the same way. God was stirring our hearts collectively, and we were physically shaken by his presence. And during this time, we just embraced one another. We were standing there holding each other as we were crying and singing. And then somewhere close to halfway through, we were singing the song, So Will I. And the power went out for a few moments. This wasn't like out of the ordinary though. Every night there was a power outage for a few moments, somewhere between the hours of 8 and 11 p.m. But it was at this time we were singing the line, If the stars were made to worship, so will I. And it was pitch black, and I looked up to see a sky full of stars. It hit me so hard. I had to take a step back and untangle myself from the people standing next to me, Dylan being one of those. And I just had to take a moment to stand there still, looking up at the sky in awe of his creation. It was so, so special, and words truly cannot do it justice. But all of that to say, the Lord took a hold of so many of us that night and woke us up. I know he forever changed my heart. It's almost like a switch flipped. I had a newfound passion for Christ as well as a newfound sense of joy and happiness. And while I considered myself to be saved prior, I believe that my relationship with the Lord truly started that night. I took the step to recommit my life to the Lord because I had been living one foot in and one foot out, just like Mr. Smith was talking about last week. And so the combination of interactions with the Jamaicans, the conversations with my classmates and Mr. Smith, and that time of worship led to a complete transformation in my life. And now I'm gonna backtrack a little bit in the week to Tuesday night. It was during our group debrief. I was just feeling super down. And as Mr. Smith was talking, I just felt like crying the whole time. He was discussing the fact that we were all experiencing this change of perspective, but what's different when we go back home? Like, what changes? And the entire time he was spoke, I was so close to having a complete breakdown. And that was because I felt called out. For so long, I would say I'm going to be better about reading my Bible and praying consistently. But being someone who has a tendency to procrastinate and is always busy, I found myself putting it off more often than not and making excuses, and so it never stuck. Well, that was the night I decided that I was totally sick of it and I was ready to get help. That's a huge part, I think, of why I was never able to make that shift, because I was trying to do it all alone. So I finally asked for help. I sought out Mr. Smith and we had a conversation about my situation. And after that conversation, I realized that there's a piece missing in my faith. And we talked about how there's more to faith than just reading your Bible and praying. Having mentors in your life is absolutely crucial. Whether that's a physical mentor that you meet with regularly or mentorship through authors and podcasts, for example. But this was not brand new information to me. It wasn't like, wow, never heard that one before. I actually realized as I was reflecting this week that the chapel series I was previously a part of back in January, the chapel before I spoke, Mr. Smith did a whole message on mentorship. Right over my head. Just totally missed that. But actually recognizing my problem here and asking for help is what made the difference. I left that conversation feeling super encouraged. And as the week went on, I really pressed into journaling and praying for direction from God, as well as for him to let me feel his presence. And the other day I was flipping through my Jamaica journal and just reading word for word my prayers that I wrote out. And then flash forward to Friday night, it could not have been more clear. All of that to say, this huge shift in my life did not occur just because I was in Jamaica. Yes, I went on this trip with the mindset of serving and growing spiritually. Yes, it was time that was already carved out for me. However, the change would not have taken place without intention and action on my part. And the good news is, you don't have to travel across the world to make the same kind of change in your own life. You can start brand new right here. You can experience God like Dylan and I did right here in Troy.
And I'm so glad that God is working in your life, and I'm so happy to see that change in your life, and I'm really proud of you. And I can't wait to continue to see God work in your life. But back to the worship night, I know for me, that was also really impactful on me. And like Lauren said, we started singing and like two songs in, people started to cry, and then I started to cry. And soon like 80% of the people there were just bawling their eyes out, and everyone was hugging and holding each other. And again, Lauren mentioned this, but we worshiped for like 2 hours long, not expecting to do that at all. But the worship leader there from Georgia, Daniel, like he just kept cranking out songs. He just kept playing for us. And it was probably the most beautiful moment I've ever been a part of. And I've never seen God move like that before. And I've never felt his presence so strongly, like in a room of people. And the Spirit was just so at work. And I remember like one time, like we were all just like singing and everyone's crying, but I look and Daniel like scans the room and he just has the biggest smile on his face, and I see him mouth the words like, wow, like this is so beautiful. And that's when it like really hit me that we were just like in this like holy moment right here. And we kind of talked about this almost before chapel, but James was sharing how he had an experience like this, and he was worshiping with a group of friends, and like the air was like different, like when he raised his hand, like heaven was like meeting earth. And that's what we felt like in this worship moment. Like I raised my hand and like I could tell like heaven's like right here, like heaven is meeting earth right now, and we are like in the presence of like God, like in like heaven right now. And it was just super impactful on me. And I just remember like crying to people, like praying over people, walking around, like hugging people that I don't even know who they are, like the kids from Georgia, like even some of them that we didn't really get to bond with as much. Like I remember just like crying into like this one person's like shoulder, and I'm like, I apologize, I don't even know who you are, and I just kind of like wept on you, but oh well. So it was just really amazing and a really beautiful moment all because we serve the same wonderful God and we were willing to turn our hearts and minds towards him in that moment. And that's what we're created to do, is be in community with each other and praise God with our whole hearts. And like I said, it truly felt like a glimpse of heaven that night. And this is the kind of spiritual awakening we want to see back here in our everyday lives. And like Lauren already said, you don't have to go on some big mission trip to experience God like this in your life. You should be able to have that same spiritual passion in your day-to-day lives. And that's the change we want to see. We want to be more intentional with the people around us and more intentional in our relationships with God. I know as a group from Jamaica, we formed like a devotional group and we already met once and we plan on meeting like every other week to keep this intentionality up, because it's not just something that happened in Jamaica. It's something that's happening right now and it's something that's continuing to happen. And so it's been really cool to see that, and I can't wait to see where that goes. And then also we heard from students who lead connect groups, and they were talking about some of the junior hires in their connect groups and what they were experiencing at Skyview this year. And they mentioned how a lot of you junior hires got to like bond and had a worship night, and you got to go up to the stage and share, and some, like a lot of you were like emotional and like you all were just there for each other bonding. And that was super cool for us to hear about, because we remember going to Skyview and having that same experience and getting to bond with our classmates. But we kind of just went back to our day-to-day lives after that, and we let that spiritual moment pass, and we missed out on a lot of things. So I challenge you guys, if you're in junior high and you experienced that bonding and that closeness to each other like at Skyview, that you take steps to be more intentional with your friends and your faith, so you don't miss out like we did. You don't have to be a senior or in high school to experience that spiritual connection with your classmates. It can start now, so I encourage you guys to keep that spiritual high up and be leaders and show the high schoolers what you guys are about. 1 Timothy 4:12 says, "Don't let people look down on you because you are young, but set the example in faith, love, and purity." You guys aren't too young to be leaders at this school. Anyone can be. So I challenge you guys just to be leaders and be spiritual leaders within your own friend groups, and just continue that, what you experience at Skyview, into your day-to-day lives. So I want to see us make this change as a school together. And again, I say all this because I don't want things to go back to the way they were. We want to keep on living out a life that reflects God, and we want to be making an effort to hold each other accountable and to walk alongside each other in our faith and stay intentional. We don't want to get swept back up into the busyness of life and forget all this life change that took place. We want to stay and reflect on these moments every day. We want this to be a bigger part of our lives, no more living for the world or for each other. We want to truly live for God and live in freedom, full of passion and fire for the one who loves us and sustains us, so that we can live in community with each other and live in fellowship with God.
So now we want to transition into a time of reflection. The change that we want to see within our school and within our relationships starts now. We have some questions with you for you to wrestle with and journal about. Being intentionally vulnerable is key in seeing growth. So after everyone is done journaling, I'm gonna ask everyone to get up out of their seats and to go share with someone. Tell them what you were journaling about and some of the thoughts you wrote down. I encourage you to engage with different people, not just your close friends, and to take this opportunity to step out of your comfort zone and to share with people who you want to be more intentional with going forward. So here are the questions. They should be up on the screen behind us. The first is, what have you been dealing with or experiencing in this past year? Then what do you need prayer for? And finally, what can you do to be more intentional in your relationships with each other moving forward? We're going to give you guys a few moments now, and then we'll be back in a minute. If you're still sharing, please continue to do so. But guys, if I can be vulnerable with people, I can be vulnerable in front of people. I no longer care what others think, because I've shared my heart and I've laid it all out there for everyone. So keep that in mind as we go into back into a time of worship.
Every day, every day. To the Bahamas for ESM, and it was with a great group of people. I had so much fun, but the best part was that we got to serve in a very poor community, probably sort of like Jamaica, but we served at a school and we got to play with kids. We did some work for them at the school, but most of these kids, they don't have hot water, they don't have running water, they don't have air conditioning or anything like that, like daily needs that we take for granted, sort of like Dylan and Lauren were talking about. Most of them come from broken homes, abusive situations. They don't even live with their parents. Their parents don't pick them up from school until 3 hours after school ended because they don't feel like it. And we take for granted the parents that we have. And so one day, it was in the middle of the week on a Wednesday, and they have chapels on Friday, but they were telling us a story of how the devil keeps attacking their worship, on Fridays. And so they were like, we started doing this thing on Wednesday where we all circle up in a courtyard and we just sing. And they play music through a karaoke speaker with a busted up microphone. And it doesn't sound great, but these kids were so happy, so happy. And standing there, I was just thinking, they have so many more reasons to let the world get in the way of focusing on the goodness of God and what he's done in their lives. And we have so many less reasons to let the world get in the way of the goodness of God in our lives. And we do it every single day. We do it here, we do it at school, we do it at home, we do it on vacation. We do it every day. They have so much less, but they seek God in that place of having nothing. And they take the little that they have and they like completely surrender it to the Lord. And like, how much do we hold on to these little things and like get worried about little things and let these little fears and anxieties take over every part of our life, even this worship in here today? I just want to take a second, if you could close your eyes, maybe throw your hands around some people around you. But just take a second to really reflect on like the goodness of God in your life, what he's done for you, how he's provided for you. Cast off all those worries and anxieties to him. Truly give it up and just focus on the goodness of God in your life, just for a second. This next song we're singing is called Goodness of God, and it's the last song we sang at this worship moment in the Bahamas, and we didn't know any of the other songs that they were singing, but this was the last one and we knew it, and they were crying and the little kids were jumping and they were all trying to clap to a slow song, and it was just the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. It was so cool. Let's go into this next song praising God for the goodness he has done in our lives, because he is good. And we have to stop letting the things of the world and our worries and all the stuff that we have or think we need get in the way of that. So, yeah.
In all my life, you have been faithful. with your might. You've always been with us. Every battle you've already won, oh, we've already won.
I'm going to close our time out in prayer, so can we all bow our heads and close our eyes? Heavenly Father, I'm so grateful that we can be here today worshiping you as a community, God. I pray that you just continue to work through each and every person's life in this room, and I pray that we see that change back here at home in our own lives. I pray that it's not just something we experienced on our ESM mission trips, but that it's something we experience in our everyday lives, Lord. And I pray that you help us continue to stay intentional with one another and intentional with you, God. We don't want to miss out on the way you are moving right now. So please help us. Give us your spirit, God, and lead us into being intentional. But we have to look at ourselves and realize that it takes change on our part, and we have to take steps towards that, God. We have to walk through the door that you are opening for us. So I just pray that as a community, we move towards that door and we take a step through that door together, God. So I just pray over everyone in this room that we continue to see the change and we continue to just feel your spirit moving, Lord. And I just pray that we don't let this be a one-time thing, that this is our reality and this is our everyday lives, God. Amen. Well, thank you guys for coming to chapel. You guys are dismissed. There is a senior meeting, so seniors need to stay, but everyone else is dismissed.